Space, the final frontier. These are the voyages of high light. Using vision. Today's topic is going to be about creating certain effects using the setup. Because there was a little bit of a question coming in where the guy had a little bit of a problem understanding like how are these different effects being created. I can just show you this on the fly. Currently I'm working with Reason 6.5, but this trick is also applicable in Reason 7, Reason 5, Reason 4, whatever. The trick that I did, or the trick that it kind of works, is that you take a device, it can be any device, and you route this thing through a audio processor unit. And this audio processor unit will always, or in most cases, be a combinator device, right there. Because the cool way with this way of processing is that you are limiting yourself with the gate events, because you're just creating an audio plugin thing. But you could do something crafty with using these rotators right here, by using the show program thing right there. The thing that I'm going to do is use the main output from the Dr. ActorX right there and stick that inside of the combinator right there. And take the combinator into the input of the mix channel. If you're using an old version of Reason, you will probably use this thing instead. This thing right there. That's the 14.2 mixer. You will probably stick it in there. Case in point is this, is that at this point, I can start loading up a drum loop, run it, and I can start stacking device in here inside of this combinator right there. And these will all become insert effects, just like that. If I can go for a delay, I can go for a phaser. Whatever. It all works. However, sometimes there is some need. Sometimes there's some need to do something really wacky. And the wackiness comes from using either the Melsum, either the Thor pads to create those programmable effects, more or less. Because that's what we're talking about. Event-driven things that do something with this base, which is based on our pattern. But because this pattern is kind of like really weird, you can create effects that have a really long time span over time, more or less. I hope that makes sense. What we're going to do is take this Thor patch and create Thor to be a audio unit processor, or an audio processor unit. We take the two devices and stick that inside of the audio input, and the audio output goes back inside the from device. In this case, it's already being connected for some reason, because I just added it there. That's the way it should be done. To process this through filters and whatever, I can use over here the modulation bus matrix. I can say audio input goes inside of the amount, and that goes inside of filter three left in, which is that one right there. Take the audio input two, that is this one right there, that's the right channel, and stick that inside of filter three right in. Which basically means if I trigger the run button right here, it will sound exactly the same. But in this case, I can use filter slot 3 to add any filter that's out there. Well, with most common effect patches that are out there, at least from the older versions, that is, this was like a common setup to use it. Because at this point, I can use, for instance, a low pass ladder filter and use a lot of resonance on top of the sound to create something really unique from this whole thing. Take an LFO and connect that to, for instance, a filter 3 frequency right there, which means that this LFO right there is now connected to the filter frequency right there. Put that thing in tempo synchronized mode and take a pattern that is kind of like stepped in a way, like that, just like that. It's a random thingy, so this knob will just go up and down like random. Something in that area. You get stuff like this going on. At this point, the drum itself is not even recognizable anymore, because I'm cutting off most of the highs, because it's a low pass filter, but I'm also putting a lot of resonance on top of the whole thing using a self-oscillation right there. Self-oscillation means that you're putting a sine on top of the sound itself. So in this case, I can turn this thing into like an AM filtering kind of thing, because that's like self-oscillation right there. Putting a sine wave on top of that whole thing using the frequency knob right there. If you don't like it, you could always turn it off. Simply put, I'm going to crank up the drive just a little bit, because another thing that I could do is process this audio signal further by splitting this thing up into multiple segments, where I say something like, okay, one segment to go left and the other segment go right, more or less. It's an idea, it's all an option. To do that, I'm going to take this Spider Audio Emerging Splitter. I'm going to disconnect the audio output and stick that inside of the split segment of the Spidey Audio Merger. This is going to be our splitter, right there. Splitter. The thing that I'm going to take over here is two times a RV7000. Because believe it or not, even while the RV7000 is just a reverb, it can be used to create creative effects. How that may sound like. I will just show a couple of examples of this. Watch what happens. I'm going to take a line 6-2 mixer. And I'm going to take this audio output inside of the audio input, and then take the other one inside of the audio input, and take the audio output inside of channel 1, and take the other output inside of channel 2. In this case, I can split this thing up to left and right and have the audio output from the line 6-2 mixer back inside the combinator from device right there. At this point, the audio signal from left and right will be similar, more or less, because I'm using two times the same reverb. But I can also start making changes within, for instance, the decay. So the sound starts to move from left to right, more or less. Because that has something to do with the time duration over left is different than the time duration over right. That's the decay. To make it visual, I can say remote programmer right here. And here you can visually see what's going to happen over here. This thing over here, this curve, is smaller than that curve right there. So what will happen right now is that this sound, with its randomness, with the LFO right there, will start to move from left to right, like somebody's like walking through my head right now. Put the high EQ all the way up, damp all the way down. So in this case, we're kind of creating the Blair Witch Project in Reason. Based on a single drum, using a little bit of resonance on top of the sound itself. But, like I said, it's an effect unit, the RV7000. I can turn over here on the EQ enabled, which means that I can start EQing bits and pieces differently. Put that thing in EQ mode right there. And then take a thing like, let's go for the parameter gain, and I can drop the gain right there. Which basically means that I'm doing a similar trick as using something like a StuFX M-class equalizer right there. Have a parameter selected and drop the gain like that. But this is all internally inside of the reverb itself, so it's a different outtake, or the output might be different than using an EQ at the end. Next thing, let's do the same thing with the second one right there, but have the EQ stage differently. Something like that might work. Just creating space over left to right, more or less. Of course, I can still tweak this filter frequency right there. So to program this whole mesh with having a reverb that goes like left, right and whatnot, I can start making changes within this sound engine by using, for instance, over here, rotary 1 is going to be connected to filters. There you are, filter frequency 3 right there, which is that knob right there. So I can call this one filter, just like this. And I can start making changes within the filter. Or I could do the same thing with the resonance. Right here. Say rotate 2. It's going to be controlling the filter. Filter 3 resonance right there. That's that knob right there. And I could, for instance, take self-oscillation on and off by using button 1 right there. And say filter 3 self-oscillation right there. That's off. That's on. That's off. And that's on. And if you want to have something rhythmic going on, you could always go for this approach over here, where you put this thing into play and say run, or in this case, if I would actually start pressing play over here, this thing will automatically start running. The cool thing with the setup, however, is that I can use the curve 1 over here inside of the step sequencer to make changes within this realm of the Thor patch. So for instance, if I take this chorus flanger over here, I could crank up the feedback amount, for instance using the curve right here. What we're going to do is say step sequence, or yeah, step sequencer curve 1 amount, and that's going to control the chorus flanger feedback amount right there. So in this case, I can start making changes within that chorus flanger by using these rotators over here. This is just a single pattern that I'm creating. Right there. Making changes within the sound. And if I'm going to drop the reverb right there, you might notice what kind of glitches you're going to create. If I turn this thing off, there. This is the normal behavior on a chorus flanger. But one of the things that I'm doing with this curve right now is putting this thing upwards and downwards rather fast. It just goes like on, off, random, whatever. Whatever I want to do with it. By turning the thing like that. It kind of creates glitches on top of the sound. But it doesn't really get noticeable when I'm going to crank up this RV7000 right here. But it does have a nice impact on the texture level of it all, because that's the whole concept and idea behind these setups. Is you're creating like little textures on top of the sound itself, which can have a really nice impact from time to time. To enable this effect, I can also use a scaler, for instance use a button, it's going to be modifier button 1, that's over here. If I turn this thing off, the effect of the chorus flanger will be gone, just like this. Turn it off right there, effect is gone. Turn it on, however, then all of a sudden that chorus flanger flipping thing will start to become active again. So you get these glitches back. Turn it off again, and it's gone. Simply put. I can combine this with, for instance, the dry wet balance of this chorus if I want to. So let's do that. Take button 3 over here, or button 2. I'm going to call this the chorus flipper, whatever. Chorus glitcher would also be a nice name. And the thing that I'm going to program is over here, knobs, buttons, button 1. That's the enable part over here. That's that one. This controls now that feedback flipping thing that it goes upwards and downwards. Next up going to be button 2, and that's going to be the chorus flanger amount. And that is inside of the effect segment where I can't find it. There you are. Dry wet balance right there. I'm going to go for a pheromone that's going to be 90. So this is flipping on and this is flipping off. Flipping on. Flipping off. But I also want to do something with the RV7000 over here, because I have two different rotators which control the master amount. So I can use rotate 3 over here to determine the dry wet balance of the reverb effect right here. So I'm going to say master dry wet balance, and for the second one, dry wet balance on rotate 3 right there. That's with, and that's without. And I can also determine the amount, just like that. Another tricky part would be flipping the EQ stage. And that is kind of like using this parameter over here. That's parameter frequency, right there. And use that against the rotary. And to set that one up, I could take RV7000 number 1. Take that against rotary 1. And control the EQ stage of parameter frequency, right there. EQ parameter frequency, that's the one. And what we're going to do is do the exact opposite way. One goes from 0 to 127, and the other one goes from 127 to 0. Just like this. Just like that. So if I flip this rotary right here, that center will now mean that these two frequency stages will be exactly the same. Right there. But as soon as I'm going to flip this thing downwards, just like that, that means that this one goes to the left and that one goes to the right. Do it the exact opposite way, that means that this thing goes to the right and that thing goes to the left. So you have full control on how you want this EQ stage to be run. This is just one setup, but I could go rather effective on this whole matter is if I take a thing like an echo. Who said an echo should be an echo? Screw that, I could also do something this. Make it really short, like that. Just like this. 10 milliseconds. What we're doing is creating a really small delay space. And this small delay space will turn it into like a coarse flanger effect again. Just like that. But in this case, I can also reduce the diffusion amount, just like that. So at this point, I'm creating like a, well, call it comb filter or a coarse flanger thing, but then differently. Just like that. And again, I can use this EQ knob right there to make changes within the sound. But other than that, I also have over here a third button that I can use for creating sound effects. I have here a mixer panel right there, and I can add an additional effect, let's call it a RV7000, and use this knob to control the amount of this effect. Right there. So let's just do that with the toggle button. That one. Take the line 62 mixer right here and take button three two times, and have the auxiliary of the send right there, channel 1 auxiliary send, and then take that to channel 1 and channel 2, just like that. So when I'm going to flip this button, I'm just going to reduce the amount just a little bit. When I'm going to flip this button, that effect, that is this effect right here, will be enabled and disabled. So that's enabled. That's with the additional reverb. That's without. So I could call this one effects, like that. And use this to control not only the EQ stage, but I could also control that send effect that I have right there. So I could say something like, yeah, well, you know what? I'm going to control the master decay amount, for instance. Make it longer and shorter. Why not? Put that thing in play right there. Just like that. And I could again enable that coarse flipper again right there. And I can play with the filter. Just stuff like that. Simply put, The only ingredient you need is something like a Thor patch to route the audio, incoming audio, through that whole thing. Then you can change that whole system, where you basically say something like, I have an audio input and it goes through filter 3. Then you can control anything that's within that filter. You can also control the different effects. You can also add a delay on top of that whole sound. Just like this. Okay, I'm clipping on it. Create something random like this. Or I could go for comb minus like that. Pack up the restless, just like that. It's all optional. It just depends on like what is your limitation on your imagination, more or less, and how many stuff do you want to attach from one effect to another effect. Because you could also go from one Thor patch to another Thor patch, but I'm not going to do that in this setup because otherwise it's going to be like a 1 hour video thing. Anyways, hopefully this was a little bit useful for the guy that actually posted the question. Have lots of fun, and I will talk to you later.